You guys ready for the word of the Lord today? Come on, let's get right into it today. Get your Bibles, come on. Get your phone, your tablet, whatever you're going to use to get into the word of God today. And if you have the ability, would you stand to your feet? I'm going to get down on my knees. Let's go before the Lord together in prayer today and invite the Holy Spirit to come and speak to our hearts. Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, today we're so grateful we can come into your house so we can experience your power and your presence, Lord. We would ask today that as we open up your word, that you would open it up to us. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown. May it produce fruit in each and every one of our individual lives. Today, God, we acknowledge that it is the Holy Spirit who is the teacher of the church. Not a man, not a woman, not the young or the old, not the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. We came to hear from you, Holy Spirit. Be welcome in this place. Be our teacher. Be our guide. Give us your vision, your wisdom, your instruction, your direction, even the correction we need for our lives, Lord, where we're getting off track. Help us today to get back on track with you. Lord, we love you and we thank you for this blessing. We thank you for this privilege, Lord. We would ask not only this blessing upon ourselves, also we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, that are both preaching and hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. They're our brothers and sisters, Lord, and at no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else. But we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building your kingdom. So God, we would ask that you bless the Baptists, the Lutherans, the Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals. We ask that you bless Calvary Chapel and Harvest, Ecclesia and Trinity and Emmanuel Baptist, the Way and Oak Valley. God, all the great churches that are out there, Lord, the assemblies and the four square denominations. God, we would bless our Catholic brothers and sisters and Adventist brothers and sisters. Lord, if they're preaching your gospel, lifting up your name, we'd ask that you bless them as you bless us this day. Also, God, we pray for the persecuted church scattered abroad throughout the world. Lord, we would ask that you comfort them, protect them, bless them, encourage them, and strengthen them. God, deliver them from prisons and bondages and from the hand of their enemies, Lord. May they endure to the end to the glory of God. And Lord, this weekend we say a special prayer as it's the first weekend that we have a new president over our land. We would ask that you bless President Trump, that you would bless Vice President Pence, that you would bless the new cabinet members and the thousands of people in that administration that are going to be leading our nation, carrying out the executive orders that are coming through. God, we would ask for divine wisdom upon our leaders, God, that as the president and vice president make decisions, Lord, that God, even now, God, that the spirit of wisdom and revelation be upon them, God, that they would hear your voice and follow you, God, and make decisions based on your truth and not on the will of man, God. We pray, Lord God, for your blessing on our nation and on our land, God, that this land would be blessed so that we can be a blessing. God, that we can continue to send aid to the nations, that we can be the head and not the tail, above and not beneath, that God, we would lend to many and borrow from none. And Lord, we give you the praise and the glory and the honor. Most of all, that righteousness be exalted in our land. And Father God, that your goodness would flow throughout the earth, God. That we would continue to be the greatest missionary sending nation on the planet, God. That the gospel would go forth from this place, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody in agreement said? Amen. Amen. You can have a seat today. Get your Bibles out and go with me to the book of Hebrews once again. Been a long time since we've been in Hebrews, huh? Took a sidestep at Christmas time and beginning of the year, we had Mike Keyes with us last week, wasn't he great? We had a great time in the Word with Mike last week, just wonderful. Today, go with me to Hebrews, the 12th chapter. We're going to be taking a look at a section of verses in verse number 14 through verse number 17. While you're turning there, let me just remind you of some of the places we've gone in the book of Hebrews. It's been a long time that we've been in the book of Hebrews, years, as a matter of fact. And here we are coming close to the end, and we're seeing the end is in sight. Finally, there is light at the end of the tunnel, right? And so here we are in Hebrews, the 12th chapter, continuing on. And, you know, the whole book of Hebrews is all about the preeminent one, Jesus Christ. And it's about us being able to live life behind the veil, that we are able to enter into the very presence of God. God wants us to live a life with him. We can experience the presence of God every day. And therefore, that's why it talks about the veil and how it was torn and how we can enter into the most holy place, how we can go to the throne of grace and find mercy and grace to help in a time of need. And we need the Lord right now. And therefore, as we come, we see these great examples in Hebrews chapter 11 of faith. Men and women who lived a life of faith, who lived life behind the veil. People who experienced the presence of God and the greatness of God in ways that we desire and that we dream of, but that we can also obtain if we will stay in faith and if we will not give up. Then we come to Hebrews chapter number 12, and it talks about how we're all running a race, and it gives us this allegory of life that each and every one of us has a course that God has laid out before us, and that we're to stay in faith, that we've got people cheering us on from heaven, and that now we are to run our race with joy, that we are to look forward to the prize. And as we do that, we also have the heavenly coach. In fact, he's the heavenly father who disciplines the children that he loves, so that we don't get off track, so that we don't get off course, but that we can stay going on with God. So with these thoughts in mind, that I want to take you to Hebrews the 12th chapter and start in verse number 14, and we're going to read through verse number 17. Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 14 says this: "Pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord." Verse 15: "Looking carefully, lest anyone fall short of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up cause trouble, and by this many become defiled." Verse 16: "Lest there be any fornicator or profane person like Esau, who for one morsel of food sold his birthright." Verse number 17: "For you know that afterward, when he wanted to inherit the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place for repentance, though he sought it diligently with tears." Now, oftentimes, as we read line upon line and precept upon precept, as we go throughout the Word of God, like we do here at this church, we would oftentimes just take one verse. We would take maybe just one word out of a verse, and we could expand on that, and we could take weeks just looking at certain subjects from the Word of God. But as I read through this section of scriptures, I realized that these scriptures, you know, there's really a theme that is running through them. Today, I want to talk to you about bitterness or blessing. See, each and every one of us in our lives, we can have a choice. We can have bitterness or we can have blessing. And I see in these verses, you know, that when this was written, this was a letter. This was not written in chapter and verse like we have it today. This was written as a continuous thought. In other words, as we run our race with life, as we receive the correction of God and we get back on track, we need to strengthen the hands that hang down. We need to strengthen the feeble knees. And now we need to make straight paths for our feet. And it says in pursue, in our pursuing, we're to pursue peace with all men and wholeness, without which no one will see the Lord. Now, the thought doesn't stop there. It continues on. In fact, the next two verses are a continuation of the very same sentence. And we can see in each one of these verses that there is a subject. There is either the bitterness of life or there is the blessing of God. And that as we look at our life, we can choose really what we have in our life, whether it be bitterness or whether it be blessing. So it says, pursue peace with all people. Now, we understand that that is a pursuit, that we're not going to have peace with everybody. There are going to be people who you just don't get along with. Some of you say amen, but don't say it too loud because you know that person's sitting right next to you this morning. But we're not going to like everybody. We're not going to have this wonderful, hunky-dory, you know, kumbaya experience with everybody that we come in contact with. There are going to be people that are opposed to the will and the ways of God. And it says, pursue peace with all people. In fact, the book of Romans, we'll take a look at this more as we go throughout this series. It says, pursue peace as much as it is dependent on you. And in other words, whatever you can do to keep peace, you should be a peacemaker. You should maintain peace on your end. Now, you can't be responsible for people on the other end. That should be a freeing thought for some of us in this place. You are not responsible for the attitudes or the actions of other people when it comes to peace. You are responsible for your own. And so you are to pursue peace with all people. Unless we get the wrong idea, he says, and holiness. In other words, it's kind of like one thought begets another thought, right? It's almost like he said, pursue peace with all people. And by the way, you don't want to do that without pursuing holiness too, because without that, no one will see the Lord. Let me give you a real world example of this. What if we were to say we're pursuing peace with people who are opposed to Christianity, that are murdering Christians on the other side of the world? And we went to them, we said, we want you guys to have peace. We want you to stop murdering Christians. And we said, what do we have to do in order to have peace with you? And they say, renounce Christ as your Lord and Savior. See, we would immediately say, well, no, we're not going to do that. In other words, we're not going to have peace. Why? Because that would compromise our holiness. That would compromise who we are. That would go against the things that God has outlined for our lives. God does not want us to renounce him. He wants us to hold on to him. He wants us to stay with him. And for us to renounce Christ just for the sake of peace would go against the principles of God's word. Therefore, we are to pursue peace with all men and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. In other words, we are not to compromise our holiness just to have peace with other people. Now, from this thought comes another thought. He says, looking carefully, lest anyone fall short of the grace of God. Remember, he said just a moment ago that without holiness, no one will see the Lord. Therefore, he says, look carefully, lest anyone fall short of the grace of God. Oftentimes I hear people say in their sin, in their compromise, well, you know what? The grace of God will cover it. But can I ask you something? Does the grace of God cover you when you fall short of it? Hello? See, we're pretty stupid sometimes. We think that, the grace of God will cover it. But what if you fall short of the grace of God? Does it cover that? See, we need to look carefully. In fact, that word look carefully is one word that we find in the New Testament, and it's most of the time translated a bishop, an overseer, somebody who looks after the affairs of the church. We've heard about bishops in our present day as people who oversee a church. They're leading, they're teaching oftentimes, they're making sure that a church or a section of churches is doing what they need to do, and if they get off course, they start to correct that, and they start to put things in order in the church. They maintain discipline, they maintain order in the church. And so it says, look carefully, be the bishop, be the overseer of your own life. Looking carefully lest anyone fall short of the grace of God. In other words, God expects you to watch out for your own life. Yes, I am your pastor. Yes, I'm your shepherd. Yes, I'm looking after you. And yes, when I go before God, I will give an account for how I did what I did while here on the earth, what I taught and what I said, how I counseled, all that kind of stuff. And I'll give an account for your souls, yes, but I will stand before God by myself. In the same way, when you go before God, Pastor Dan, Pastor Jim, Pastor Deborah, Pastor Jess, Pastor Luke, none of us will be standing there with you. You have the responsibility by yourself to uphold your life in Jesus Christ. And God is saying you have to be the overseer. You have to be the bishop of your own soul to make sure that when you go before the God alone, by yourself, and naked, because there ain't anything that's not exposed before God's sight, that you will be able to give an account of your life. Continues on and he says, lest there be any root of bitterness springing up, causing trouble, and by this many become defiled. Lest there be any fornicator or profane person like Esau. See, as we look after the activities, the pursuits, the intent, and the direction of our hearts, God is saying that peace is able to be obtained with all men as much as it depends on us. And that secondly, as we watch out for ourselves, that we can have that holiness. Holiness is just simply exclusivity with God. In other words, I am exclusively God's. Therefore, I am holy. In the same way, when you gave your heart and life to Jesus, you didn't give it to Jesus and you gave it to Jesus alone. And therefore, you are holy. You are set apart. You are sanctified. You are now somebody that is holy unto the Lord. You are exclusively His. As you watch out after your soul, you now can become holy in the sight of God. We're to watch where our heart is going and to correct any wrong direction, just as a bishop would in the church. We are responsible for our own lives. We are responsible for who we are and what we do. God is making sure that we watch out. Now, this root of bitterness that we see in the Bible, many times people think that that only has to do with our relationships with other people, but I'm going to show you today that it goes much further than that. If we're going to get to the root, if we're going to find out that root place, then we have to trace this thing back. And how many of you know everything in the Bible, when it comes to our lives, it traces back to one place. Every root starts in the heart. Now, all of us, maybe you've never heard this before, maybe you've heard this a million times, but I'm going to tell you again so that you understand it, okay? Good for some of us to be refreshed in these things. All of us are three-part beings. You can see the outside of a man, right? That's their flesh. That's their body. Okay, that's the earth suit that we wear while we're here on the earth. And that is a part of who we are, yes. But that's not me, right? Because if you cut off an arm, I'm still here. In fact, I am an eternal being, and so are you. We are spiritual beings. God has given us the breath of life, and therefore, we have a spirit. So we are a spirit. That's the true me. That's the true you. And if you kill this earthly body, then that spirit man lives on eternally. So we are a spirit that lives in a body and has a soul. What is the soul? Well, that is your mind, your will, and your emotions. And therefore, when it talks about the heart is the seat of the spirit and the soul connected together. That is the innermost part of who you are. So it includes your spirit, the real you, and it includes your mind, your will, and your emotions, your soul. Therefore, any root that you will find that is doing something in your life that is bearing fruit out in your activities, your actions, your thoughts, your words, all that kind of a thing, it starts right here in the heart. Are you guys listening today? Let me show this to you in the Word. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23 says this, says, keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life. Now, I've read that verse many times throughout my lifetime, and I've always thought about that spring as like a freshwater spring. Out of this heart is going to just bubble up and come out the issues of life. But I had a different thought when I was reading this time around, because as I looked at Hebrews, the 12th chapter, it said, lest there be any root of bitterness springing up, right? And now here we find, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life. Jesus said that the sower sows the word, and the word goes where? Into the heart. And out of that heart will spring up fruit. Everybody tracking with me so far? See, our heart is the soil. Our heart is the garden. Our heart is the place where things are going to get planted in our lives, and they're going to take root, and they are going to bear fruit. Therefore, we need to guard our heart. We need to watch out what is going on the inside, because if it's the wrong thing, it will produce the wrong results. But if it's the right thing, according to what God says, then it will produce good things in our lives. Is anybody listening today? Now, we see that there are three warnings that come in this passage. First one is this, in Hebrews, the 12th chapter. First one is, lest we fall short of the grace of God. Second one is, lest any root of bitterness spring up and defile many. And the third one is, lest there be any fornicator or profane person. Now, it's almost as if the author of Hebrews, as these thoughts just keep going on, that he's almost like unearthing a plant. Like, he was walking through the garden, he saw a big weed, and he said, you know, I'm going to pull that stupid thing out. And so he grabs a hold of it, and he tries and yanks it up, and he can't get it up out of the ground. So what does he do? He starts to dig down. And as he starts to dig down, he realizes something, that this thing is unholy, and therefore, as he goes down, he realizes this is going to fall short of the grace of God. And then as he digs further, he realizes this is bitter. And this will defile many if it produces fruit. And as he digs further down, he realizes that this thing is profane and likens it to a fornicator, someone who is having sex outside of marriage. And so he gets a hold of that, and really down at the base of that, it looks like something when he pulls it out. It looks like an example that we see in the Old Testament of a man named Esau. Now, in Hebrews, the 11th chapter, examples abound of faith-filled men and women, right? We've got all sorts of examples of what we can learn, what to do from what they did. We see their example of faith, and therefore we can follow that faith and get the same results that they got. Is that right? In the same way, the Word of God will also give us negative examples at times of things not to do. Are you listening? And today we see an example of a man by the name of Esau, and what he did in his life that we should not imitate in our own walk of faith. Because if we do, we will reach the wrong results. Need to follow the godly example and not the unrighteous example. Let's take a look at the life of Esau. Turn with me to Genesis, the 25th chapter today. Genesis chapter number 25. While you're turning there, let me tell you the story. Some of you guys, this will be a refresher once again. Some of you guys remember the flannel board. You guys been in church a long time. Some of you guys, this will be the first time for you. First time we find out about Esau, there was a man by the name of Isaac. Isaac was Abraham, the great father of faith's son, right? He was the son of promise. Isaac marries a woman by the name of Rebekah. Isaac and Rebekah get married. As they get married, they do what married people do, and they end up pregnant. She has twins, okay? And these twins, they come out at birth. Hello. And so here they are, and Esau comes out first. Now, Esau is hairy, he's red, and he comes out, he's the firstborn. But then his brother comes out following him, and as his brother comes out, his brother is holding on to Esau's heel. Literally, from the womb, he's got his hand wrapped around Esau's heel, and therefore they named him Jacob, one who holds the heel. Or another term for Jacob is supplanter. You'll find that in your Bible, right? For those of you that have a little study guide thing or the little letter next to it, and then you look down, you find the word, it'll say supplanter. What does that mean? In other words, Esau had a position as the firstborn son. That position, he stood in, okay? But Jacob comes along, and Jacob is holding onto the heel. Now, if Esau thought he was standing steady, and Jacob came and he grabbed along the heel, and he shook him there at the heel, what would happen? Esau could lose his ground. Is that right? So therefore, they called him Jacob the supplanter. Now, Esau grew up to be a wild man. This guy was out there in the fields. This guy was out hunting. This guy would be out in the wilderness. I mean, he had that red hair. He was so hairy. I mean, his arms were all hairy. He was just this big, massive man, right? Loved to hunt, loved to go out. He was probably sweating. It smelled like brute. I mean, this guy was a man's man. Now, Jacob, on the other hand, is very different from his brother Esau. Jacob, the Bible says, was a dweller of tents. That's a fancy way of saying he was a mama's boy, okay? Jacob liked being in the tents. The women were in the tents, and so Jacob was hanging out with mama and all the maidservants and all that kind of stuff. And, oh, you need some help cooking that? All right, let's go over there. And Jacob he just was that kind of a guy. He didn't want to be out there in the fields. He didn't want to go hunting. He wanted to hang out. He wanted to experience the you know, kind of the city life type thing, you know? And he was a, you know, good dude. And so here one day, Esau comes in, and he's just exhausted. He's been out in the fields. He's been out running. He's been out sweating, right? And so he comes in, and he finds Jacob, and Jacob is cooking up some lentil soup. And so Esau says, give me some of that soup. And Jacob, like any good brothers, said, nah, right? I'm not going to give you any of my soup. Esau says, come on, give me some soup. I'm dying here. Like, I'm so hungry, I'm going to die. A little dramatic, Esau, right? Don't you think? But Jacob says, no, I'm not giving it to you unless you sell me your birthright. Remember, Jacob was the supplanter. Jacob was the one holding on to the heel. Even though you're going to be firstborn, Esau, I'm holding on to your heels. I'm nipping at your heels. I'm coming after you. And so now Jacob's true nature comes out at this point. He says, sell me your birthright. Esau says to Jacob, what is my birthright to me if I die? In other words, it's not going to be any good to me if I just fall down and die right here. And so he says, I'll give it to you. Give me the bowl of soup. And in Genesis, the 25th chapter, very last verse, verse number 34, look at what it says. And Jacob gave Esau bread and stew of lentils. Then he ate and drank, arose, and went his way. Thus Esau despised his birthright. Now to despise something means that you counted it of no value. You put no weight on it. In other words, this is a hated thing by Esau. Esau despised his birthright. Now, we all would say, well, what's so bad about that? You know, here he is, he doesn't have the birthright anymore. We don't really understand that in our present-day Western society and culture. But in this Eastern mindset, in the Jewish mindset here, we find out that the firstborn had privileges that the other ones did not have. As the firstborn, he had first rights to property. And in fact, when they divided up all of the father's goods, the firstborn got a double portion given to them as the firstborn. Now, stop and think about this for a second. Isaac, right, was the heir of Abraham. Abraham was a very rich man, so rich so that him and Lot couldn't even stay on the same plot of ground. God abundantly blessed Abraham. Abraham had 300 servants born in his own house. Come on, somebody. This guy is filthy, stinking rich by today's standards. Okay? So here's Abraham. Abraham's goods are passing to Isaac. Isaac is the one who went and he sowed in a time of famine and he began to prosper until he continued to prosper until he became, the Bible says, not just a little, but very prosperous. So Isaac was filthy, stinking rich. So here's two rich kids. One's the dweller of tents, right? He's the one that's driving around the BMW around, you know, all the different area of Canaan and all that kind of stuff. And then here's his brother out there with the latest, greatest hunting bow and all that kind of stuff. And they're having a quarrel over a bowl of soup. And Esau gives up a double portion of his rich daddy's inheritance for a bowl of lentil soup. Come on, you guys. Have you had a bowl of lentil soup lately? It's not that great. I apologize to my vegan brothers and sisters who are hating on me right now. Kale lovers, unite, okay? Right after service outside somewhere else. But think about the trade. That no way adds up. But he despised his birthright. It wasn't about stuff. He just hated that. And he didn't want to identify as the firstborn son, and so he gave it up. And when you give up your birthright as a Christian, you give up your blessings. We don't realize that they're tied together. But they are. And as Christians, we need to realize and recognize and put weight on the fact that we are holy unto the Lord, that we are sons and daughters of the Most High God, and that we have blood-bought birthrights, and that we are rich kids, right? Because our Father owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. Our God is the owner of the heavens and of the earth. The earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. See, we are King's kids, and we better not despise our birthright because our birthright is tied to our blessings. And don't you lie in church. You know you want to be blessed. Nobody in this place is saying, I don't want to be blessed. I want to be cursed. No, you all of us, me, we all want to be blessed. But our birthright is tied to our blessings. See, Esau, the story goes on. Esau, one day his dad tells him, I want you to go and make some food for me, such as my soul loves. And as I eat it, I will bless you, Esau. And so many times, you know, we put on praise and worship music to get ourselves in the spirit, right? And therefore we'll bless God and we'll bless others and we'll do our thing, right? Isaac, the way to his heart was through his stomach. So he said, Esau, make me some food, all right? And so as he goes out, Esau goes out, and Rachel pulls Jacob aside and says, Jacob, hurry up. I want you to go put on some goat skins over your arms so that you feel like hairy like your brother. And then I want you to put on your brother's clothes so that your dad, when he smells you, you'll smell like brute, right? And so he says, and she says, I want you to make some food. I'll help you make some food. And as we make some food, then I want you to bring it into your dad and pretend like you're Esau, and I want you to get the blessing. And Jacob says, wait a second, Mom, hold on. What if dad realizes it's me, Jacob, and not Esau? And what if he curses me? And she says, the curse be upon me, my son. Now, her words in some ways did come true, because after this incident, she sends him away to her brother, and she never sees Jacob again. She dies before he makes it back. Now, Jacob takes the advice of his mom. And lest we think that Jacob was right in his deception, remember that what Jacob sowed, Jacob also reaped. That deception that he sowed into his own family, into Esau, into his dad, he reaped that from his uncle Laban for 14 years while he waited for his bride. So we need to understand that if we go after the blessings of God, see, with Jacob, the reason why the Bible says Jacob I love but Esau I hated is not because of Jacob's ways, but because of Jacob's heart. Because Jacob was pursuing the blessing. All of his life, he had that heel of Esau. He had a hold of it at birth. He went after the birthright and got a hold of it. And then he went after the blessing himself. In fact, you will not find Jacob in the Bible where he's not going after the blessing of God. When he's wrestling with the angel at Penuel, what is he doing? He's wrestling that angel, and the angel says, let me go. Now, that angel could have crumpled him. That angel could have took him out. And yet, Jacob says, I will not let you go unless you bless me. And therefore, he blessed him there, and the sun shined upon Jacob. Yeah, he walked away with a limp, but he walked away with the blessing of Almighty God on his life. So here Jacob brings the food into his father. And his father says, wait a second, Esau, is that you, my son? He says, yeah, it's me. He says, well, wait a second. It sounds like Jacob. He says, I've got food for you. He says, bring it to me and let me eat, that my soul may be lifted up and that I may bless you. So he eats the food and he says, come to me, my son. And he comes over to him and he feels his arms and he feels the hair of the goat skins. And he says, it's Jacob's voice, but it's hairy like Esau. And he pulls him in closer and he smells the brute on his clothes. And his soul is lifted up. I'm joking, by the way. You guys are stuffy in this place, second service. Everybody else laughed at that stuff. Come on, you guys, lighten up. And so he pulls him in and he smells him. And as he smells him, he smells the clothing as of Esau. And his soul is lifted up and he starts to bless him. He blesses him with wine and grain and the fatness of the land. He makes him ruler over his brother and he blesses him in the name of the Lord. And therefore, Jacob goes out from his presence. A moment later, Esau comes in with his food. And he says, Father, here I am to present to you the food that you may bless me, that your soul may be lifted up. And here Isaac trembles. He's shaking. See, Isaac couldn't see, but he could hear. And Isaac's eyes had grown dim. And therefore, he says, who is that? And he says, it's Esau. And he says, then who was just here? And he says, it must have been that scoundrel Jacob. He's stolen my birthright, and now he's stolen my blessing. And he weeps, and he cries, and he wants his dad to change his mind. He says, Father, don't you have another blessing for me? And he says, no, my son. I've already given him the fatness of the land. I've already given him the grain and the wine. I've already given him, I made him ruler over you. And Esau weeps and weeps and weeps because he wanted the blessing, but he didn't want to do it the way of God. See, in our lives, we got to recognize and realize that our birthright is tied to our blessings. When we give up that birthright, we will lose our blessings just like Esau did, who is a profane person in the sight of God. As we take a look at pursuing peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord, we need to recognize and realize that the principles of holiness will guide us through these other areas so that we will not fall short of the grace of God, so that we will not be someone who has a root of bitterness in their heart, so that we will not be somebody who is a profane person or a fornicator like Esau was. The principles of holiness will guide our lives in a couple of areas, and I want to just bring these out quickly today as we go throughout the Word of God. The principles of holiness will guide our lives to, number one, is value our position with God more than our personal appetites. Oftentimes, I find people who sit in churches and call themselves Christians that will give up their position as a Christian for their personal appetites. God, I want your blessings, but right now I'm going to do me. God, I like the thought of getting healed. I like the thought of getting blessed. I like the thought of prosperity. But you know what? I also like this over here in the world. I also like messing around. I also like the drugs. I also like the alcohol. I also like the pornography, God. Why can't I do both? Why can't I have both? And God says, it's all or nothing. This is not about you do a little bit of you, you do a little bit of the world, you do a little bit of God, and you get a little blessing from you, and you get a little blessing from the world, and you get a little blessing from God. No, what you sow to the flesh, you will reap corruption, but what you sow to the spirit will reap everlasting life. There is no in between. It's all or nothing with God. See, our appetites can actually drag us away from God. It was in eating that Esau lost his birthright. And it was in eating that Adam and Eve lost perfection. They lost the kingdom. They lost the Garden of Eden with God. See, they could have ate any tree that they wanted to. And yet, what did they do? They decided to go independent. They went rogue. And they rebelled against the commandment of God. And rather than sticking with what God said and not eating, they ate, and therefore they fell. See, in our lives, it's no different. When we go independent of God's word and we stay away and we indulge ourselves in the fruits of this world rather than in the spirit of God. See, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. See, it was in not eating, hello, that Jesus, when he was confronted by the devil in the wilderness, overcame the temptation of Satan. It was in his fasting, it was in his abstaining that Jesus was able to say, I'm not going to turn these stones into bread like you want me to, devil. I know I'm the Son of God, you know I'm the Son of God, but I don't have to prove it. I'm not going to indulge in my fleshly appetites. And therefore, he was able to pull out the sword of the Spirit and say, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. See, if we are going to overcome in this area, if we're going to put aside our personal appetites, it's going to be in not eating, in not diving into our pleasures, in not going after the things of this world. We have to value our position with God as Christians, sons and daughters of the Most High God, greater than our personal appetites. Is anybody listening today? Come on, somebody. You can say amen. It's okay. John chapter 4, verse number 34, Jesus has an encounter with a woman at a well. She's a Samaritan woman. Now, number one, for a Jewish rabbi to be talking to a woman, that was one thing. But then add on top of that, she's a Samaritan. She was hated by the Jews. Why? Because the Samaritans were half-breeds. They had inbred with the nations around them, and therefore they were despised by the Jews because they were considered to be impure. And therefore, here Jesus is, this Jewish rabbi, this teacher, going, who's claiming to be the Son of God, and there he is, speaking to a woman and speaking to a Samaritan woman. They have a conversation, and after that conversation, the woman takes off, and she runs out. And in John chapter 4, we find the disciples come to him, and they realize what was going on, and they brought some food to Jesus. And they start urging Jesus, Jesus, you need to eat, man. We've been walking a long ways. We've been traveling. You know, you haven't even got a drink yet. You were supposed to get a drink when you were here at the well, but you didn't even get a drink. You made us pass through here. We were going to go all the way around, but here we are. Jesus, you need to eat something. Come on and eat. And Jesus refuses to eat. And look at what Jesus says in John chapter 4, verse number 34. Jesus said to them, my food. Everybody say, my food. My food. In other words, our food is that which fuels us, the thing which propels us forward. Jesus says, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. When we look at our lives, our fuel is not our personal pleasures and appetites. It is not our fleshly desires. Our food, what fuels our life, what carries us forward, what moves us on, is to do the will of God, to finish the work of the one who sent us as his sons and his daughters. Second thing is this, the principles of holiness will guide our lives to not only value our position with God more than our personal appetites. Secondly is this, is to give up temporary satisfaction for eternal blessing. To give up temporary satisfaction for eternal blessing. See, Esau was called a profane person. What does that mean? That means he was ungodly. Literally, if you look it up in the Greek, it means someone who crosses a line. See, Esau, as he despised his birthright, he started crossing lines. There were boundaries that were set up, and there were things that the firstborn should do and should not do. And Esau, in his heart, started crossing lines. What is that if I die? All of a sudden, he's talking about it. He sells his birthright. He goes off and he does his own thing. He's independent of God. He's running rogue. And now, all of a sudden, here Esau is, a profane and godless person, and God hates that. God does not like when we go against and when we despise the things which he has freely given to us in Christ Jesus. The word goes on and it says, a fornicator, right? What is a fornicator? Well, we know on the base level, it's someone who has sex outside of marriage, but that root word is even deeper than that. Really, it could mean a whoremonger, as you see in the old King James Version, or a male prostitute. Now, for the family rooms, you guys got your little kids there. If you want to cover their ears because you don't want to have this conversation later, I understand, okay? So I'll tell you when you can uncover their ears. But a male prostitute, why not a female prostitute? I think it's this reason, because many times you will find that women were viewed as objects, as slaves, that sort of a thing. As well, when there was a woman who lost her husband and didn't have any children, she didn't have any ways or any means of working. And therefore, the only way that she could provide for herself was to sell herself in order to take care of herself. But a male prostitute was different. A male prostitute would have been a person who sold themselves when they didn't need to. In other words, they were going to sell themselves for their own pleasures. This was a person who would sell their rights as a man, somebody who could work, someone who could take care of themselves in order to prostitute themselves for their own personal pleasures and for their own personal gain. Esau, as he sold his birthright, became a profane person and went into this male prostitute sense where he sold himself. He sold who he was. He sold the most intimate thing about himself in order to gain temporary pleasure. Is anybody listening in this place? I know this is tough stuff, and I know I'm cutting you open, but I'm going to show you up in a little bit, all right? Esau lived on impulse rather than on eternal thought. Esau was more concerned about his blessing apart from God's ways than he was about staying within the boundary lines. See, the psalmist writes, the boundary lines have fallen to me in good places. Parents, you can uncover those ears if you need to, okay? The boundary lines have fallen to me in good places. What does that mean? That means that God has set out. We're all sheep, right? You think about a ranch. If there was a big ranch that had hundreds and hundreds of acres, and around those acres, the rancher put fences, right? And here he puts up all these fences. Why does he do that? He does that to keep the sheep in a boundary, to keep them in a place of safety and protection. Think about these boundaries. If it's hundreds of acres, maybe there's a river flowing through it or some trees for shade. There's plenty of grass. There's plenty of room to go around. But for some reason, we as sheep, we've got these hundreds of acres. We've got this liberty in Christ Jesus, and yet we're sitting at the fence looking over the edge going, boy, I wonder what it's like over there. And we start to wander, and we start to nibble our way out, and we start to cross those boundary lines. And you know what happens? A wolf comes, and it takes us and tears us apart. And that wolf is the devil. That wolf is the world. And things that will draw us away from God. See, if we would just stay in the boundary lines, there's safety, there's blessing, there's protection, there's every good thing that we need. And yet we're looking over the lines going, I wonder what it's like over there. When God says, stay close to the shepherd, there's safety, there's protection for you. We don't want to cross lines. We don't want to go after fleshly lusts, selling ourselves in our carnal desires. Romans chapter 6, remember I told you I'm going to sew you up? Romans chapter 6, if you're dealing with this today, if your heart's getting pierced, that's a good thing, because godly sorrow leads to repentance, which leads to eternal life. But if we sorrow as the world sorrows, then we never change, and we never do anything about it, and it leads to death. Today, I want to give you some life. I want to give you some encouragement. Romans chapter 6, and if you're dealing with this, Romans chapter 6, 7, and 8, okay, read all three of them, meditate on them, study them, write down notes as the Holy Spirit speaks to your life. Romans chapter 6, we're going to read just verse number 22. But now having been set free from sin and having become slaves of God, you have your fruit to holiness. Notice there's what for holiness? You have your what? You have your fruit. You know where there's fruit, there's a root, right? And where does that root start? In the heart. Some of you guys were listening, okay? The rest of you guys are tracking, all right? In the heart. It starts in the heart. So he says, if you are slaves to God, if you do things God's way, you don't go independent of God and you don't live on impulse now, you are a slave. You only do what the master says. Then you have your fruit to holiness. That means the root inside of you is good. And then it goes on and says, and the end, everlasting life. In other words, you will give up your temporary pleasures in order to have eternal blessings. Is anybody listening today? Spurgeon said this. He said, unless your holiness is uniform. I mean, if your life is angelic abroad and devilish at home, you must suspect that it is at home that you are what you really are. I question whether any man is much better than he is thought to be by his wife and family, for they, after all, see the most of us and know the truth about us. That man is not right with God who would not do the same in the dark that he would do in the light. It's good. It's good. See, for all of us, our character is what we are, regardless of circumstances, regardless of place. That is our character. And true integrity means that you sustain, you hold up the same image no matter what. Integrity, speaking of a ship, talks about a ship that even though it's battered by wind and rain and waves and storms, even though it can hit up and be dashed against the rock, it holds steady, it holds strong. And God wants to build holiness into our life, which will build the godly character that he wants to see in us. And it will keep us strong and steady through the storms of life. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, let's go there. Sometimes people say, well, what's the will of God? What does God want for my life? God, what does God want from me? And in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, we find one of the scriptures, and there are many throughout the Word of God, that talk about the will of God for our life. You know, one of the will of God verses said, God wants you to be thankful. That's part of the will of God. So if you're unthankful in this place, hey, that's not the will of God. But we should be thankful. Every day we should wake up, thank you, Lord, for another day. Every night when we go to bed, thank you, Jesus, for this wonderful day. He said, but it was a bad day. Thank Jesus for the terrible bad day, because that's the will of God for you in Christ Jesus. Look what it says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse number 3 and 4. It says, for this is the will of God. In other words, let's take out the questions. What is the will of God? This is the will of God, your sanctification. That word sanctification is another word for holiness. It has the same root word. And it goes on that you should abstain from sexual immorality. If you were wondering if what you were doing outside of marriage is right, it's not. It's wrong. Okay, and at this church, we tell you the truth, and I will get in your face. Why? Because I love you, and I'm going to tell you the truth, and one day I'm going to stand before God and give an account for your soul, remember? And therefore, if I just patty-caked it and said, oh, it's okay, just keep doing it, it's all right. You know, the world says if it feels good, do it. But no, God says abstain. Don't eat of that tree, because its fruit is bitter, and it's going to poison your life. That you should abstain from sexual immorality, verse 4, that each of you should know how to possess his own vessel in sanctification and in honor. In other words, don't go trying to own or possess someone else's vessel. Hello? You possess your own vessel. Make sure that your vessel is integrous, that it stays steady and secure. Drop down to verse number 7, for God did not call us to uncleanness, profaneness, fornication. God has called us in holiness, that we are exclusively God's and that we are following him. Last thing for today, the principles of holiness will guard our lives. Number 1, to value our position with God more than our personal appetites. 2, to give up temporary satisfaction for eternal blessings. And the last one is this, to hold out for God's best. Hold out for God's best. See, in your single life, singles, God's best for you is that when you get married, then you can enjoy the pleasures of intimacy and marriage. That's God's best for your life. Businessmen and women, God's best for your life is that you will prosper, not by cheating on your taxes and making temporary pleasure money, but rather that you would do things with integrity and hold out till God prospers and blesses your business. God's best for each and every one of us as husbands and wives is not to go around to other people and seek satisfaction in pornography, in perversity, or in the arms of another person. No, it is to repair the damage that's been done in our own marriages, to stay together and stay in love and stay in faith. And as we grow together, that we will just mutually encourage one another and build one another and submit to one another in the fear of the Lord. God's best for us as parents is to do the will of God, to raise up a standard. Don't let your children parent you, parents. You parent your children. Don't let them tell you, I don't want to go to church. Listen, you're my kid. You want to eat my food, live under my roof. You're going to go and serve at my church. And you're going to understand the things about my God. And when you grow up, you can make your own choices. But right now, you're under my authority. I'm making the choices for you. You say, but they don't like it. They won't do it. No, you make them do it. Otherwise, you shut their water off and see how they like that. You got to provide a bed, a mattress on the floor. You don't even have to provide a sheet. You say, you want a sheet? You better be good. You want to be warm at night? Okay, come on, Toro, come on. Oh, you like those chips? Those are my chips. I bought them with my money. Thank you very much. Well, we're letting the children parent us. I don't want to go to church. I want to buy these clothes. I want to have this video game. I want to do this. I want to do that. No. You're the parent. God's best is that you would raise them up in the ways of the Lord, that even when they grow old, that they will not depart from it. They might not like it now, but when they grow up and they're bearing fruit, good fruit, they'll thank you for it. Hold out for God's best. Esau was content to go without his birthright, but still wanted the blessing. Isn't that amazing? There are many people that don't want to identify with Christians. Oh, but they want the blessings of God. I don't want to serve the Lord the way that he wants. I don't want to abstain, you know, but I still want to be healed. Oh, I don't want to do that with God, but I still want to be blessed. I don't like tithing, but I still want to prosper. Oh my gosh, guys, you cannot have the blessing of God apart from your birthright with God. And if you despise the birthright, you will lose the blessing. See, not everyone who participates in life gets a trophy and a pizza party at the end of it all. Am I talking to anybody today? Come on, not everybody who participates in life, when you go to before the throne in eternity, God says, well, you participated, there you go, and there's some pizza and ice cream over there. Go ahead, kid. No. You're going to answer for what you did while in the body, whether good or whether evil. There are eternal rewards and there are losses that we can suffer as Christians. We will come out smelling like smoke and we will suffer loss. Or we will go to hell if we despise our birthright and we fall short of the grace of God. It's just how it is. Read your Bible. I didn't write it. But you have to stick to the rules to win the prize. If you want a reward in eternity, hold out for God's best. Compete according to the rules and you will win the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. And don't let go like Jacob. Have a heart that goes after the blessing of God so strong and so long that you finally get it when you wrestle with God and you say, I'm not letting you go, God, until you bless me. Deuteronomy chapter 29, verse 18 in the Living Bible says this, the day, everybody say the day. The day that any of you, man or woman, family or tribe of Israel, begins to turn away from the Lord our God and desires to worship these gods of other nations. Listen, that is not God's best. And that is not holding out for God's best. See, they might desire it because they might say there's no rain. Maybe we should worship the gods of the rain of this area. Wait, there's no fertility in the land. Maybe we should worship the gods of fertility. And rather than hold out and wait on God, the day that you turn away from God to worship these gods of other nations, that day, everybody say that day. That day, a root will be planted that will grow bitter and poisonous fruit. Guys, it will kill you. If we allow our hearts to turn away, remember, everything starts in the heart. If we allow our hearts to turn away from God and that bitter root takes hold inside of us, it will kill you. It will bear poisonous fruit. You cannot eat poison and live. It will kill you. See, Esau would have been content with a second-rate blessing. God, Dad, isn't there anything left for me? Don't you have anything left over? We say, well, wait a second, what about the woman who was content with the crumbs? See, she had no birthright. But she said that even the dogs get the crumbs. But listen, when do we ever see in the Word of God that Jesus, God Almighty, the Holy Spirit said, my kids licked the crumbs off the ground? That is not our blood-bought birthright. And now the Gentiles are no longer dogs outside. No, now we are part of the family of God. We have been adopted into his family. We have a place at the table. What are you doing licking second-rate blessings off the ground of this world? We need to put that stuff away and get it out of our lives. See, Esau didn't store it for himself, but he banked on a blessing that never came. And he indulged in the flesh rather than waited for what God would have given him. God would have given him much more than a bowl of soup. God would have given him the fatness of the land and wine and grain and the increase, and he would have ruled over Jacob. In fact, Esau would have been in the lineage of Jesus Christ, but he gave that up for a bowl of soup. The old King James says for a mess of pottage. That's pretty appropriate, isn't it? Some of our lives are a mess of pottage, and we wonder why we're not blessed. It's because we've despised our birthright. Remember, I said I'm going to sew you back up. 2 Corinthians chapter 7. I'm going to end with this. 2 Corinthians chapter 7. Turn there with me. 2 Corinthians chapter number 6 tells us about all the blessings that God wants for our lives. Tells us that God wants to be our God. He wants us to be his people. He wants to be in the midst of us. He wants to be our light and our salvation. He wants to overflow with blessings and have the presence of God. Where God's presence is, there his power is. And if we're God's children, then we have an inheritance. Jesus Christ is the firstborn, and yeah, he gets the double portion, but guess what? I'm Jesus' brother, you're Jesus' sister, and we all have an inheritance that's coming to us eternally. And therefore, he says this in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse number 1, therefore, in other words, just because of what I just said about all the things that God wants for our lives, therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Now, notice it doesn't say, go to God and make him clean you up, because God already did his cleaning work on the cross. Positionally, you have a positional holiness and sanctification and righteousness before the Lord. That when you gave your heart and life to Jesus, he cleaned you up from the inside out. But in practice, We have to now cleanse ourselves. In other words, it's a partnership. We have a responsibility to work together with the grace of God to clean up our lives. In other words, get rid of the explicit lyric CDs or music that you have on your MP3s, on your phones, all that kind of. Get rid of those rated R movies. Get rid of that nudity. Get rid of that pornography. If there's relationships dragging you down, delete those numbers out of your phone. If there's something holding you back from the best of God, then you need to get it out of your life and cleanse yourself because of the promises of God. If you want the blessing, you got to stay and you got to hold on. And notice what it says, perfecting holiness. Aren't you glad it says perfecting and not being holy right now already? You got to be perfect right here, right now. See, this is a process in our lives. Holiness and sanctification is something that we work at each and every day. We work at it with the Lord. Are we going to slip up? Are we going to fall? Yes, but repent and turn back to God. Now, we might get confused and say, well, Esau sought it, but he found no room for repentance. So have I already given up my birthright? Have I already given up my blessing? Well, listen, that was after he had already blessed Jacob. And Esau came seeking the blessing, but not the birthright. If you notice, Esau didn't repent himself. He wanted his dad to repent. He was trying to tell his dad, don't you have another blessing for me? Don't you want to change your mind? It's just like Simon, right? Here's the sorcerer coming and asking the apostles to buy the gift of the Holy Spirit that when he lays his hands on people, they will receive the Holy Spirit. Peter says, your money die with you. I can sense that there is bitterness on the inside of your heart. And he says, you should repent. Perhaps the Lord will hear your prayer and forgive your sin. And Simon turns around and he says, you pray for me. Wait a second. No, cleanse yourselves. See, there is room for repentance if you will go after it. If you will change your heart, if you will change your mind, if you will turn to the living God. See, if there's things in your life that you know are bitter and poisonous that you need to uproot, ask the Holy Spirit to reveal those things to you and spiritually get a hold of them and pull them out by the power of God and repent of those things. Get them out of your life and turn back to the living God. See, we have this time here and now on the earth to remember, to repent, and to return to the Lord. God is asking you if you will come to him and you will bring him all of your life, perfecting holiness. It's a journey. It's a journey. And maybe you messed up this weekend. Maybe you messed up last night. Maybe you messed up this morning before you came to church. But guess what? You're in the right place. Today, the open arms of the Savior are here. God is saying, I want to bless you, but you got to do it my way. Don't despise your birthright, but put into practice the principles of holiness. Principles of holiness will guide our lives to value our position with God more than our personal appetites. Secondly, the principles of holiness will guide our lives to give up temporary satisfaction for eternal blessing. And finally, the principles of holiness will hold out for God's best. I'm going to ask everybody to remain seated at this time. No one get up, no one leave. I want to make sure before you leave this place that your heart is right with God. Because if you died right at this moment, right here, right now, you would end up in hell and you would not go to heaven. I want to make sure that your life is right so that you go on with God and that you don't go on in eternity without him. So everybody at this time, just take a moment. No one get up. No one leave during this time. Don't be texting or any of that kind of stuff. Just focus in because God wants to speak to you. I'm going to ask everybody right now to just take a private moment with God. I want you to bow your heads. I want you to close your eyes. And I want you to think about your life. What if today was your last day? Would you end up in heaven or would you end up in hell? Some of you in this room may have said, well, I think I'd go to heaven. Some of you said, I hope I'd go to heaven. Some of you said, maybe, I really don't know. And some of you in this place said, no, I know I'd go to hell. And if you answered that question in any of those ways, I want to give you an opportunity today to give God all of your heart and to give God all of your life. Jesus said you must be born again to enter the kingdom of heaven. There's no other way you're going to make it. You can't make it by cleaning up your act and being good. Sometimes we think if we can be good enough that God will let us into heaven. But this is not about behavior modification. This is about heart transformation. You must be born again. It's not about being raised in church. Sometimes people think if they're just raised in church, their parents tell them they're Christians, taking religious classes, or they wear religious jewelry or a t-shirt that says Jesus, that gets them into heaven, when nothing could be further from the truth. Sometimes people think if I'm just born in America, America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. But nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents raise you in church and tell you're Christian, and that because you're born in America, you get to go to heaven. Sometimes people think that just because they sit in a church now in their adult life, consider themselves to be a Christian, it makes them a Christian. And yet, can we sit in our garage, call ourselves a car, and that makes us a car? It doesn't work like that. Sometimes people think, well, all roads lead to heaven. No, they don't. Any more than all roads on the earth lead to the moon. There's only one way you're going to get there, and that's God's way. And Jesus said you must be born again. Sometimes people think, well, maybe if I just volunteer enough or help out enough in church, do enough good things in the church, that God will notice and let me into heaven. But nowhere in the Bible does it say your volunteerism. Nowhere in the Bible does it say God's looking for a membership card to a church before you can enter the gates of heaven. Sometimes we think things like, well, you know, I know God and I know about the scriptures and I could quote them to you, Old and New Testament. I believe that God's going to let me into heaven because I know him. But you know that the devil knew who Jesus was. Demons knew him, knew he was the Son of God. They cried out. They trembled at the mention of his name. They know who he is. Devil, you'll find quoting scripture in the Bible. Yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. You must be born again. Now, I know our society's made a mockery out of that term, made it out to be something that it's not. But let's not let society, Hollywood movies, television, books, and the internet define for us what being born again is. Let's let the Bible do that for us. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. It's all or nothing with Jesus, like we talked about in the message today. There is no in-between. You can't have a little bit of the world and a little bit of God, and hopefully you'll get a little bit of heaven. It doesn't work like that, because then you'd get a little bit of hell too. It's one or the other. And you have the free will choice while you're here on the earth to choose whether you go to heaven or whether you go to hell with your life. Remember, I said the day of repentance is today. Now is the time of salvation. We are not guaranteed tomorrow. Don't think that you're going to get away from this by, you know, saying, I'll do it another time. Listen, there were plenty of people in the Bible that said they were hoping for a better time. They were almost persuaded, but then you never hear about them again in the Bible. We are not guaranteed tomorrow. People down the street in the IRC, December 2nd last year, didn't think that they were going to be in eternity when they went to a Christmas party that morning. And yet, in a moment, their life was over. We are not guaranteed tomorrow. Jesus could come back at any time. We're all one accident, one incident, one virus away from eternity. All you have is right now. So I want you to look into your heart, and if you're not born again, if you know that you wouldn't make it, or maybe you're questioning your life, maybe you're lukewarm, you say, well, what is that? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, a little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything, and you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with God, you're not going to make it. I'll just tell you that right now. Why? Because Jesus said in the book of Revelation, if you're lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. He'd rather us be hot or cold. But what does that mean? That means that lukewarm Christians are not real Christians at all, and you're not going to make it. So today, in a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this, in this quietness and this stillness, as you're considering where you're at with God. And I'm going to count to three and go, pop my hands together just like this. One, two, three, bang. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart, I want to give God all my life, I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. And then I'm going to gather up afterwards, and we're going to pray together. Simple prayer to invite Jesus in your heart. You're going to be born again. If you want to be included in that prayer, be born again, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell today, right here, right now. Get ready to get your hand up. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television, in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, or even online, wherever you're at, across the nation and around the world, get ready to get your hand up. God sees, and God's watching. You can pray this prayer as well, right where you're at. Who should raise your hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today is your day. Make sure. Who should raise your hand if you've never done this before, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand if you're lukewarm in this place, been playing games with God, messing around, half in, half out? Come on. Let's go all out for Jesus. Let's get all of our heart, all of our life, so that we can be headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. Here we go. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. You want to be included in that prayer? Get ready to get your hand up. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. There's one, two, three. Thank you. There's four. God bless you. Who else today? There's four. There's five. Got you over here. Thank you. Five, six over there. Thank you. God bless you. Who else today? There's six wise people on this side. Seven. Thank you. Eight. Got you over there. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Thank you. Up there, number nine, got you over there. Yes. Who else today? Nine wise people already. Anybody else real quick that I did not already see? If you know I saw you, you can get your hand down. But if you haven't, oh, thank you. Thank you, number 10. God bless you. Got you over there. Who else today? Number 11, got you over there. Thank you. Anybody else, you're saying, I need to give God all my heart, need to give God all my life. I want to be included in that prayer today. Headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. Is there anybody else real quick on this side? 11. Thank you, 12. God bless you over there. Gotcha. Anybody else that I did not already see? If you're wondering, maybe I should do this. Yeah, you should. Let's go for it today. Did embarrass them, and I won't embarrass you. Anybody else? We're going to pray a prayer in a moment. If that's you, you want to be included in that prayer. Come on, get your hand up right now. There's about 11 or 12 wise people already. Anybody else? This is the last call, and then I'm going to wrap it up. We're going to pray together. Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise today for about 12 wise people. Okay, let's pray together. So those of you that raised your hand, or if you should have raised your hand, but you didn't, it's not too late. Once you get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend of you, a friend, once you get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies today. So let's all stand and welcome them as they come. And if you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, come on down to the front right now. If your children raise your hand, bring them right now. This is their time too. Come on down. Come on down. Come on, you can come too.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again?
Come on, they're coming.
Nothing
they're coming.
But the blood of Jesus. So
you can come too. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Anybody else, if you need to come, just make your way to the front right now. Come on down. Okay, while I give some instruction, if you still need to come, you're welcome to come. But I want everybody up front to look up here at me for a second. Put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing. Came to give God all of your heart. Came to give God all of your life. Walking away from your old way, going on God's way. Okay? Getting that birthright that we talked about so that you can be blessed every area of your life as you hold on to the promises of God. Let's all bow our heads at this time. Let's close our eyes once again. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. Put your heart on the Lord. Remember, this is about the heart. Those of you that are watching online, if you raise your hand, come on, put your heart on the Lord right now. And everybody together, I want you to say these words out loud and say, Father God, I come to you now in Jesus' name. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that he came, that he died, and he's raised again to life just for me. God, I give you all of my heart and all my life. Come into my heart. Be my Lord, my Savior. Forgive me my sin. Wash me with your blood. Cleanse me of my past. And give me a brand new start with a brand new heart. Fill me now with your Holy Spirit. And let it be known that from this day on, I am a Christian. I'm saved. I'm headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise today. Woo! God is good. All right, all you guys, now listen. We want to get some free stuff in your hands, okay? We want to bless you with some things that will help you to find out what to do next in your walk with God. So you see this guy waving at you right over here to my right, your left. This is Pastor Joel. Really good guy. Wants to give you that free information, talk to you about a program we have here. Basically, someone in church who will help you get strong in the ways of the Lord so you go on with the blessings of God and you don't go back to the old ways, all right? Don't despise that birthright. He'll talk to you about that. It's easy. It's free. You need to do it, all right? And then he'll let you guys come right back out. Take a couple minutes of your time. Your friends and family will wait for you. Just make a left turn and follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give a hand as they go. Hallelujah.